Welcome back to Unlock Your Creative Curiosity with Tammy Collins, where we explore, experiment, evolve, express, and evoke creativity. This series is about color swatching. Here's a sneak peek at what's coming in this video. Okay, we're going to dive in with this custom-made journal. It's basically a black hardcover journal that I purchased at Hobby Lobby. And I decorated it with some of these papers, and I used Mod Podge. I can't get my thoughts together, sorry. So anyway, I just decorated the cover, and I'm using this journal. I'm dedicating it to swatching my mediums. And today we're going to do Tombow brush markers, which I love. They're a water-based marker. And what I have here is a list of all the markers that they have, the colors, and then I have a color chart. And then I organized my markers by the number in order from Tombow. So they're in these little boxes that I have, and they're in order as the chart goes. I also have a little water here because I like to use these markers a lot as a watercolor effect. And then I just have a couple gel markers or pens, excuse me, that I'm going to use to label the boxes. I have a couple of markers here that have the number has worn off and I don't know what they are. So I'm just trying to see what I can do. They're basically dried up, but I don't have all of the Tombow markers. So I'm just trying to figure out. And one of the reasons that I'm swatching this is because I want to know exactly what I have. And that way I can order the missing pieces. I apologize for the lighting here. It's absolutely glorious. It's beautiful, sunny out, but it's so sunny that I can't keep the curtain open or it will cast this bright glare across the table. So the curtain's pulled, so it's creating a little bit of shadow there. But again, we do things perfectly imperfect around here. The idea is that I'm just sharing my creative time in the hopes that it inspires other people to be able to do things in their creative time and to show them that it isn't always perfect and there isn't always a plan and things go wrong and that's it. I do these in real time and I do speed the video up slightly so you're not terribly bored. And then I come back and I put some audio over it. I find that that's the most beneficial for you as the listener. It actually helps me because I can talk a little bit better about what I'm doing. Doesn't interrupt my creative flow. So I have pre-marked out squares in my journal here, which is just a piece of cardboard that I determined what the squares would be. I cut the squares out and now I have the same pattern that I can always repeat within this book. And then I'm going through and I'm using the Tombow marker chart that gives you all the numbers and names. And I'm just marking each block all the way through. And that way, when I come back with the markers, I'll be able to know what goes where. I find that swatching is super important. I mean, if you've ever done anything with any creativity or any art projects of any kind, you will find yourself getting whatever you're using, whether it's paint, watercolor, markers, whatever it is, you're going to end up having a scrap piece of paper next to you that you're going to start you know marking on to see what the actual color and pigment looks like on paper so that you can determine if it is the color that you want to use at that time in your piece in that moment. I find that swatching like this cuts down on that significantly. I still tend to do it a little bit, but having the swatch there really cuts down. It shows you and helps you make a better decision about the colors that you have and what you want to use. In this particular case, it's also helped me organize what I have and knowing what I need and, you know, when it runs out, what I want. It helps me know which ones are my favorites, what colors I gravitate to. It takes a little bit of time, but it's well worth the effort. And honestly, my swatching methods weren't quite this clean and organized previously, but it's something that I've committed to myself to do. We're going to be doing a lot of that on this channel where I am using it a little bit as accountability for myself. Even me, I need accountability, right? We're going to do a lot of different types of journals. For example, this journal I'm dedicating to swatching. So this will have swatched. I guess I should tell you what swatched is. Swatch, we're just taking the medium and creating a little swatch, if you will. So I have a little square there that I'm coloring in and making a swatch, a sample of that marker on this paper in this book. And so the swatching is really helpful, and this journal is going to be dedicated to swatching. We're going to do some other journals. We'll do a journal dedicated to coloring, and all about color. We're going to do one all about mark making. We're going to do one all about inspiration. We might even delve into a vision journal and a few other things. And so I'm just going to show you this process. It's a little tedious. I will kind of pause and skip through a little bit. I'm not going to do every single color. Otherwise, I think you would get bored to tears. I want you to have the idea and see what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. And, you know, maybe other people swatch this way, but this is just how I decided to do it. And I am coloring the outside of the box with the finer point. I dripped water on there and splurt and made a mess there with the drip of water, but that's okay. We're perfectly imperfect. And I'm going to say that all the time because I did suffer terribly with perfectionism issues. And I've been working over the last 5 years or so to overcome that. And so I have to constantly remind myself that it's perfectly imperfect. And it's been a huge help to me and in my growth and my personal journey. So we just roll with mistakes now. And sometimes they are and almost always turn out to be a blessing or an enhancement into what we're doing. So this marker here is really dried out. This is avocado. I use this a lot, you can tell. But I'm going to force it in there. Didn't really come out that great. But that's okay. I really love markers in general. They feel good in your hand. They flow consistently and easy. These Tombow markers in particular are water-based, and they really function nicely as almost like a watercolor element. If you've been watching my videos or seen anything that I do, you'll notice that I tend to use these a lot. And the way I use them is a little bit different than maybe others use them. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to go through every marker that I have in the Tombow line, and I'm going to swatch every single one of them. I believe they have 102 total colors. I'm not 100% sure on that. I went to their website and I downloaded their list. 108. It says there's 108 colors. Now, I have seen several color charts that indicate that there are 96 colors. It is possible that they are removing, maybe they're removing the grays. No, they're on the gray. I don't know what they're removing. So I'm not 100% accurate on what they have, but they have around 100 colors. I will include the link to their website in the more section, the description section, so you can check it out for yourself. One of the other things I love about them is that they come in pre-organized sets. So if you're a saver like me, you wait for coupons or you wait for sales, you know, places like Michaels and you know, Dick Blick and those types of places, they'll run sales on it and you can get the sets, which makes the per price of the marker more affordable. Now, the only problem with that is occasionally you'll get a duplicate marker. I have 3 or 4 duplicate colors, which I don't mind because it's just a backup for the color when the other one dries out. But this is why I'm swatching, because now I am missing a bunch of colors. And so now I'll need to order individual sets because the prepackaged sets, I think I've gotten all of those. The only couple that are left have too many duplicates. So I use a a rule that I kind of go through, and I, if it has more than three duplicates, I don't, it's not worth the effort. And so what I'll do now is I'll wait for sale and I'll purchase the individual markers, which is another thing I love about this brand. You can get individual markers. So when you have a color that you love and it dries up, you can just get that color. I don't know. Do you swatch your mediums? Do you have any particular mediums that you swatch that were a real surprise to you and how that turned out? Do you have a particular style or way that you like to swatch? I think we're going to also swatch the Posca markers that I have. And I might do that in a completely different way. I haven't decided just yet. Only because I really don't want to waste any ink. So I may try that slightly different and we'll see how that comes out. But on this channel, we're going to do a lot of recording of my daily creative time. So one of the things, being a creative, I get asked to do lots of unique things. And so sometimes my creative time isn't something that really is easy to record or film, you know, so I can't always share every little thing. Hopefully someday I will be able to do that. But right now I'm working on a very large outdoor sign for an upholstery shop. And so it's about 8 feet long and 4 feet high. So I'm working on that as my actual creative time. And so that's why I decided to just do swatching here. I also would like to have a playlist here on this channel that will be more about the how-tos of some more mundane, maybe not as interesting tasks like swatching. But I find that swatching is also very meditative. And one of the surprising things I think about swatching is that it is a great way to just kind of get some creative juices flowing. A lot of times people will tell me that they get stuck with like what I call blank page, you know, fear. Like, how do you make that first mark? Well, sometimes the easiest way to get over that is to just get going. And swatching is a great way to get going. So if you're struggling with how to begin or where to start, just do some swatching. It doesn't even have to be really fancy. Just kind of get a piece of paper and do a little bit of swatching. It'll help you pick some colors you like. And sometimes those colors will be all that you need to get going. Like you might discover this color here that I'm doing right now. You might discover, oh, I really love this color, and it might inspire you to do something. I think sometimes on the most basic level, we let just fear keep us from doing anything. And it's funny because it doesn't have to be a big fear. It could be a little tiny fear that you don't even realize is happening, like how to make the first mark on your page. Maybe it's not a literal fear, but it's a pause or a hesitation that you're sort of questioning yourself. And that's why we're going to also be doing a mark-making journal. That's another great exercise to just explore and experiment and see what you like. So don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't already. I have a lot of plans for this channel. I have been wanting to do this for a very long time, and I let some of my own fears prevent me from doing that, and I'm no longer doing that. I'm jumping in, and I'm just going with it. It's a great color. I haven't quite figured out how to address this lighting. So if you don't know, I live in a tiny house on the side of a cliff over a river, and it's glorious. And I have morning, the sun rises on, on the facing side of this window. And so the whole front of my tiny house is basically a giant window, which is to the left of this swatching book. It's only just a foot away. And so the light pouring in from the sun is just too intense. So I have a curtain drawn, like a linen curtain, to kind of cut the glare. But then that creates a little bit of shadow. So I apologize. I do have some spot lighting, but the sun is just so overpowering. So we'll figure out how to get that better for you. Thanks for bearing with me. Okay, so we're almost on the first page. I'll be pausing and skipping forward a little bit because I think you're getting the hang of what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. So to let those dry for a little bit. Okay, so now we're moving on to the next page. And so I use the finer line to outline the box, and then I use the brush tip side to sort of fill in the box. And I leave just a tiny bit at the edge there, you know, unfilled in, because I'm using some water to blend it out a little bit so that I can get a feel for what the color looks like with water. Now, this journal book isn't the highest of quality papers. It's a medium to heavy weight, and it's designed for mixed media, so it's a little rough. It also has a slightly ochre or yellow tint to it. So you want to consider that when you're doing your swatching. You may want something that has a bright white color. Sorry, I have chickens out here and somebody's laying an egg. Oh goodness. But I really love these markers with the water. Takes a little practice to get used to how it works. Some colors are really amazing. Boy, those chickens are going to town, huh? And I like to use the water in the swatching because it is how I like to use the pens. So it shows me in one swatch what the color looks like straight out of the marker and how it looks when it's wet. So I keep the left side of the box straight brush stroke, and I use the right side of the box as the water or water side of the marker. I don't know what I want to call that there. So essentially in one box, I'm getting three examples of how the marker works. The outline, the brush stroke, and then the water saturated. Oh my goodness. I hope you like chickens. But again, if I waited for everything to be perfect, I wouldn't do this, right? Because I'd have to be worried about, oh my gosh, the chickens might make some noise while I'm recording. I'd never record. The chickens make noise all the time. They're singing to you. They're giving you some entertaining backdrop music. Boy, they are going at it. Mm-hmm. swatching is really great for so many projects. It's really great to have the swatching done ahead of time before you dive into your project, especially when you're using many different mediums, you know, keeping them all straight and what you want to use. It can be really helpful. It can also be a great inspirational tool to help get your wheels going. If you're going to sit down and do your creative time, if you've blocked time off in a day and you're not sure what you want to do, but this is your time to create. And that happens to me a lot. I have time that's allocated to do creative projects, and then I get there and I'm not sure what I want to do. You can flip through your swatch books and be inspired, right? So you can flip through the color book and say, oh, I love these three colors. Let's go with those three colors. And then you can flip through your, maybe you have a texture journal. Maybe that's another journal we should do, a texture journal. You can flip through there and say, I love this texture. You can have a stencil journal and you can flip through there and say, oh, I want to use this stencil. And so on and so on and so on. You can have a mark making journal. In fact, we're doing all these journals that I'm mentioning. I'm going to have to come back and write all these down. But I think that's a great way. You can even do that as like a challenge. You know, I know a lot of people love to do these sort of color swatch challenges where you purchase the color palette with an image and then you just use that and go from there. Well, I think we should do the opposite and have our own swatch journals of all different types of medium that we like, and we go through and we pick those, and then we can challenge ourselves that way. I think that's what we're going to do. So I'll have a playlist, and this is the beginning of that playlist. And the playlist is going to be, swatching, all different, medium swatching, swatches of medium. I don't know what it's called. I'm figuring that out right now as we're doing this. That's how it happens. That's how creativity happens. You do something, it leads to something else. You experiment, you explore, you play with it. It leads to something else. It inspires something else. And that's really what I'm trying to convey here in this channel. I'm going to try to keep these videos, in a relatively realistic timeline. I spend about an hour doing my creative time. I put them in the video. I sort of double time them so it keeps it to around that 30 to 40 minute mark and makes it a little bit more digestible for you to watch. Not sure how long this one's going to go, but we'll see. I think this one's right around 30 minutes. The other journal that might be nice to do is a paper swatching. That could be really great too. I love paper. There's so many types of paper. There's so many different textures and thicknesses and weights and materials that paper can be made from banana skins and natural fibers and wood and cotton and all kinds of things. And I absolutely adore paper. So maybe that's another great journal. Fantastic. That's a great idea. I didn't even think of that. Love it. I actually didn't realize I was missing so many of these markers. Gotta have them all, right? What colors am I missing? What creative experiments await by the colors that I don't have yet? Ugh. So the number on this one's kind of missing. So I'm trying to figure out exactly what number it is. And I believe it was 885. And the other thing is I have the color chart that I've printed out, but you But when you print out, the colors can be very different than the actual marker. And the other thing is by swatching, I'm sure you've seen this. When you have caps on markers, they are not very accurate. They can be close, but they're just not always accurate. And so by swatching, you really get a really great idea of what the color looks like. And so I sort of paused and jumped ahead a little bit, and I'll be doing that again because I know that you're really getting the hang of what I'm doing here, and I don't want to really be too boring. I don't know if I have enough things to say to fill the time, and I don't want to be a constant babbler. Is that even a word? But we're coming into the end of the color line. And then there will be the grays, the blacks and the grays. They have cool grays and warm grays. And so, see, I skipped ahead there. We're beginning the black. And so I'm probably gonna pause this again. I think I paused this in here somewhere and jump ahead a little bit. But you can see the interesting thing between the cool grays and the warm grays is that the easiest way to think about that is the cool grays are going to feel a little more blue, right? And then your warm grays are going to feel a little bit more green. That's just the easiest way to think about them. Oh, I did skip ahead. There we go. And you can almost see that right here. A couple of them look a little bit greener. And some look a little bluer. That's just a great way to think about the warmness or the coolness of a gray. Now, there are blender pens. I'm not, I don't think I really know how to use these very well. I'm never happy with the way they come out. But what you'll see here is that I'm going to give it a shot. And that's why there's some extra boxes here if I ever come across some blends that I really love and want to keep. But you can see here that the quality of the paper is hurting me right now because I'm kind of tearing it up a little bit by using that blender. But it just gives you an idea of what's happening. So I hope you really enjoyed the swatching. And if you want to learn more about Tombow, be sure to check out the link in the description. And we'll just do a quick look back at all the colors here. It really looks great. You can really see the advantage to doing something like this. I hope you enjoyed this. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed today's experiment with creativity. For more, be sure to like, subscribe, and follow me for more inspiration.